So many people remain in eastern Ukraine as Russia intensifies fighting in that region. Some stayed behind to protect their homes. Others did not want to leave family. Still others did not have the means or even the physical ability to leave. But now many are forced to find a way to flee just to survive, desperate to find escape routes. It's almost impossible to avoid coming under fire. CNN's Clarissa Ward is in Dnipro, Ukraine for us with one man's brave mission going into the fighting, into danger, to save those who so desperately need to escape.
It's a road few are willing to take anymore. But every day, volunteer Alexander Prokopenko makes the dangerous drive towards Russian forces in his hometown of Popasna to rescue fellow residents from the heavy fighting. They shell everything, he tells us. School buses, the Red Cross, anything that moves.
So why do you do this work?
I love my town and I can't leave it, he says. I can't leave the people here. Somebody needs to help people. He's hoping the rain provides some let up in the relentless artillery. It's better for us, but it's worse for the road, he says. You can't see the potholes and the shrapnel from the shells. He arrives at the village of Kamishevaha on the outskirts of Popasna. In the last few days, it has come under heavy shelling. Anatoly is now being evacuated with his son Vladimir. The neighbor shouts at us to show what the Russians have done. Those who stay here are now completely cut off from basic services.
So there's no electricity here, no water at all, and you can see they're actually collecting rainwater.
It's time for Anatoly and Vladimir to go. Their entire life now packed into the trunk of Alexander's car. Leaving the village, we spot a house destroyed by shelling. As we get out to take a closer look, a tearful Galina Nikolaevna emerges. She tells us it happened 2 days earlier. The first hit was at 5:50, and then there was a second hit, she says, and that hit my garage. She takes us around what remains of her home. The steady thuds of artillery can still be heard.
The roof is completely destroyed.
This is where the first shell hit, she says. Galina had just woken up and was lying in her bed when it happened. We have nothing left, she says. In the living room, she takes down the drapes that were hung to hide any light. This is how we tried to mask ourselves, she tells us. There's no need for them anymore. Galina and her husband still don't want to leave their home, but she understands that Russia's offensive here has only just begun, and it's going to get much worse. I lived until 60, and now I have lost everything, she says. Honestly, I have no words. For those like Anatoly and Vladimir who do leave, there are few good options. Alexander takes them to a dormitory in the nearby town of Bakhmut. They can stay 5 days for free. After that, it's up to them. In the next door bed, another couple rescued by Alexander tell us there is nothing left of their home, but they don't blame President Putin. Thank you, America, she says. It's a horror. It's a nightmare.
So it's interesting. She's saying that she thinks that Russia actually wanted to negotiate here. And she blames America primarily for this war.
Putin wants to find a peaceful solution, her husband tells us. Please don't tell this bullshit to the whole world, Alexander says. It's not an uncommon view in these parts of eastern Ukraine, making the situation here all the more complex. Alexander says he evacuates anyone, whatever their political views. He knows there are still so many out there who need his help.
Now, Jake, according to Luhansk authorities, 100 people were evacuated from towns around the region today, including 60 from the town of Popasna. That's the focus of our story. But Alexander says he estimates there are more than 1,000 people still left in that town. And when I asked him why so many consistently refuse to leave, he said again and again, listen, people in this area do not have a lot of money. They have worked so hard to build their homes, and they are simply not willing to leave, not knowing where they're going, not having any clear infrastructure to help them get there. And so they are willing to take the chance and try to sit it out. But the problem becomes that once the fighting really intensifies in these areas, it is then, in most cases, too late to try to safely evacuate civilians, Jake.
Clarissa Ward in Dnipro, Ukraine. Thank you so much.
Live to Ukraine now for the very latest. CNN's Matt Rivers live for us in Lviv. Matt.
Yeah, John, we actually just got back not too long ago from the train station here in Lviv, and we saw firsthand the kind of tragedy, the horrific idea that not enough people are getting out of Mariupol that need to be getting out of Mariupol. You talked about the horrific situation there right now, and there are tens of thousands of people that should be evacuated from that city. But the fact of the matter is, despite the fact that there have been multiple humanitarian corridors set up over the past week or so, the number of evacuees getting out of that city due to, Ukraine says, Russian shelling and Russia ignoring ceasefires, the number of people getting out has slowed to a trickle. So we went to the train station here in Lviv hoping to see people from Mariupol getting off a train specifically designated for evacuees. And it was just a handful of people getting off a train that could have easily held hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. And it was very emblematic of what we've seen out of Mariupol over the past few days. Just not enough people getting out. Though the people coming out of Mariupol, not the only evacuees from this country that are facing just life and death situations. We know that as the fighting continues in the eastern part of the country, people have been urged to evacuate from places like the region of Luhansk. And we heard from Ukrainian officials today that Russian forces actually targeted a bus carrying some two dozen evacuees. And at least one person was injured as a result of that. So not only is it difficult to even find a bus to get out on, John, but then you run the risk of being shot at by Russian forces once you do so. Horrific to be an evacuee in Ukraine. And just as you mentioned off the top before we send it back to you, the idea that Russian forces now openly admitting what so many of us have long suspected, that Russia wants to take over completely the southern part of the country, all that access to the Black Sea. We've known publicly they've wanted to take over the Donbas region, but now the idea that they want to complete the land bridge that would extend from the Donbas region in the east all the way down to Crimea in the south, a very significant development and one that should have the city of Odessa nervous, that city largely being able to escape the brunt of the Russian onslaught so far, but given Russian statements today, could very well be in the Russian military's crosshairs in the weeks to come. John.
Important reporting in context. Matt Rivers live in Lviv. Matt, thank you.